they can make it. We would like to have the army reorganized and restructured. We suffered a lot from the military, and up until now, we witnessed that the military were against freedom, against democracy. We'll have to convince people that the army can help us sometime to achieve freedom of the civil society. We would like to have a fair trial for our president rather than constituting a special tribunal for him. Mubarak has to be tried. His son needs to be tried as well, because he was the source of corruption in the country. We need to work toward educating our people. Many of them are absolutely illiterate. We need to ensure literacy. They need to be able to read and write. And we also need to inform them about economy. And we also have to provide literacy to women. The principle of mutual benefit, of a win-win situation and mutual respect has to be promoted. During that diplomatic mission that I mentioned in Uganda and Ethiopia, we managed to discuss some issues related to the religious concept and the joint usage of the water in the River Nile. We actually became convinced that these countries are friends of ours. They're close to us, and they mean no harm to Egypt. We became aware that they're working towards the interests of their own countries, and they mean no harm to Egypt. We will try to set up a joint project to create a popular Ministry of Foreign Affairs, a joint ministry between those countries. And we will set up a diplomatic mission which will deliver services to every Egyptian or every other citizens from the countries in the region in order to promote investments. And this will be to the interests of our peoples. A very important point is related to the Israeli-Palestine conflict, which has been going on for a very long time and has reached a point when everything came to a stalemate, but this needs to be brought to an end as well. Corruption needs to be eliminated, and there should be a revolution which will cover all areas of life.
Next, I would like to mention, as Mr. Hassan said, I really have nothing but admiration for Mr. Mladenov, the foreign minister, and the other speakers before me. I am proud that people like them occupy such important positions at such a young age. 10, we need to seek to liquidate fundamentalism and revenge seeking, as well as the differences and the infighting between Muslims and Christians. These sects, which are mutually opposed, should try to reconcile with each other or be placed under government control. All possible obstacles should be swept aside. We should work for the rights of the so-called minorities. Under Mubarak, we had friends among the Copts, the Christians and others. They demanded of us that their rights be protected. Also, we should seek to protect the rights of women. How can we protect something that is missing altogether. Any citizen, whoever he or she may be, irrespective of their religious affiliation or gender, should have the rights which will need protection. Next in line, we should improve the civil society in Egypt and Africa. During this mission that I undertook, I witnessed that there is a huge difference between civil society in Europe and in Egypt. But as I went to Ethiopia, I saw that the situation there is even worse than Egypt. If we head further south towards Uganda, the difference becomes a chasm, a huge gap, religious and cultural, on account of the low educational status of the local people. And lastly, I would like to tell you that what happened in our countries, people ask me, a woman asked me, why are you against Mubarak? And I said, what he did in Egypt, what he caused to the Egyptian people. As our conversation progressed, she got the gist of what I was telling her, and she said to me, how have you had the patience to put up with this guy, Mubarak, so far? We came here to tell you about what was happening and what is happening in Egypt. We have benefited from your experience, from your practices, and I would like to see you all in Egypt in the near future. I want to once again emphasize that Egypt is a secure country, that its civil society needs your support, and that we need a relationship with other nations and their cultural values, because what's happening now is not only about financial interests, but also about cultural heritage.
Or discussion, if we're going to stick to the program. I think one of the things that I've noticed, which encourages me, that there will be a good cooperation between East Europeans and Arabs, is that there is flexibility in the concept of time. So we will may extend a little bit. Please, you have a question.
My name is Mohamed Khalaf. I will speak Bulgarian to demonstrate that I know Bulgarian also. I am from Iraq. The statement from the gentleman from the Hayat, Al Hayat newspaper has prompted me to ask a question. I have been following the Islamic movements, both the militants and those who present themselves as the political Islam. And I remember that before the Gulf War, before the war in Iraq, Vice President Dick Cheney received an Iraqi delegation that comprised everybody from the political Islam faction, the Shia Islam. On the way out from his office, there was a French cabinet minister who had an appointment with Cheney to talk to him later. And Cheney said to him, I just met the people who will be doing democracy in Iraq. 8 years later, it turned out that those politicians, that those political parties finished what Saddam Hussein was unable to finish, namely to destroy Iraq altogether. To my regret, the ruling party, the ruling political elite in Iraq at present, the Shia Islamists and the Sunni Islamists, have brought my country to a civil war. Currently, both in Tunisia and in Egypt and in Libya, every Friday, people come out and they rally against the regimes. And at the same time, every Friday, young people who are dissatisfied with what's happening in Iraq, although they are not declaredly against democracy, they come out against the authorities. I just want to say, my question is that political Islam, as a matter of principle, has no governance program. Political Islam is a big problem for Arab societies. Although from the presentation of my colleague, Mr. Emin, I heard that if given more freedom, these people would be more useful for their societies. This is what he meant. But I say that in Iraq, they have every freedom imaginable. I mean the political elites, but they have brought the country into an abyss.
This question has been dealt with by all the speakers, not just Mr. Amin. So we'll hold on that. Let's get one more question. Yes, please.
Monsieur le Président, ce dernier panel est censé ouvrir sur...
Mr. Chair, this last panel is about building bridges between Europe and the Arab world. What worries me is that in order to build a bridge, we need to raise the bets. We need to lay the foundations for that bridge. I'm talking about the Fortress Europe, the idea that the source of danger is the part of the world where we come from. And the entire Mediterranean region in March of this year, and even today, but back in March in Libya, there was a popular movement that wanted to get rid of Gaddafi. But Gaddafi turned to the European Commission demanding 50 million euros to guard the coastline. And he got the money. On the same day, Tunisia requested European assistance to control its own borders, and revolutionary Tunisia received 28 million euros. I just want to tell you that as long as there are these mechanisms within Fortress Europe based upon suspicion and mistrust towards us, there is no bridge building. As I came here to Sofia, I was lining up at passport control like everybody else. There were two green passports, two Arab passports on the plane. A green passport automatically triggers suspicion. When we're facing the window of the border control officer, we spend 10 minutes there, and people waiting in line behind us become resentful because we're the usual suspects. A green passport means suspicion. As long as there is suspicion, there can be no talk about cooperation or common programs. There can be no common future. To a certain extent, this is a matter of changing perceptions and ideas. There must be a revolution in ideas as well.